around the globe outside of America have this as their favorite book of the Bible. Because as we're about to see from some of these statistics, a lot of the Christians in the world suffer unbelievably so. And so this book gives them great comfort as they go through it. And here are some statistics for you. 13 Christians, and this is every day, by the way. So every statistic I'm about to tell you is every day. 13 Christians are killed for their faith every day. 12 Christians are unjustly arrested or imprisoned. 5 Christians are abducted. And 12 churches or Christian buildings are attacked. In 12 countries on the planet today, there are extreme levels of persecution. And in 42, there are very high levels of persecution. And this includes killings and church burnings and abductions and forced marriages and imprisonments. But what we've also seen, especially with the pandemic going on this past year, is that in a lot of these countries, if someone was getting shorted on relief for COVID, it was Christians. And so around the world, and these are just a few statistics, you can look up more if you want. Voice of the Martyrs is a great organization that has these statistics. Around the world, Christians have been suffering basically from day one of Christianity. And I want to use this little bit of statistics to remind you, if you aren't already, to pray for the global church. Because Christianity is beyond America. And there are some Christians who are going through some horrible, horrible persecution. And I don't bring this up so that we can, quote unquote, win some kind of persecution contest. So that we can leave here and go, oh, I'm part of the most persecuted, oppressed, marginalized group on the planet, which is true. And therefore, I win the oppression Olympics, or I win the suffering contest. That's not the point. The point is to tell you that, yes, there is persecution in America today. And it is something that we have to deal with. And it is suffering that we have to deal with as Christians. But it could be worse. And what we're going to see is that as time progresses, because this is always how it happens, it's going to get worse for Christians. And that's not a political statement. I'm not saying that because every branch in our government is blue right now. I am saying that because every time you look at a government, as time progresses, it tends to persecute more and more heavily Christians. And while it's not extreme here in America, we still have to learn how to suffer well. And so when persecution and suffering comes for living like Christ, Christians must suffer well following Christ's example. So hopefully you're in 1 Peter 4 already. We're going to start by reading 1 Peter 4, 12 to 14. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal among you, which comes upon you for your testing, as though some strange thing were happening to you. But to the degree that you share the sufferings of Christ, keep on rejoicing, so that also at the revelation of his glory you may rejoice with exultation. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of God, or because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. So verse 12, it starts with this word, beloved. This is the audience who's going to originally receive this letter. 1 Peter 1:1 tells us that these are those aliens, is the term that he uses, who are scattered across Gentile nations. And there's some debate as to whether this is going to a primarily Jewish congregation or a primarily Gentile congregation. That's not important. What's important is that this letter is going to believers. And these believers are suffering what Peter calls here a fiery ordeal. And some scholars believe that this is actually an allusion to a type of persecution that they were experiencing. Because this letter comes out right around the time that Emperor Nero becomes emperor of the Roman Empire. And if there's something you should know about Emperor Nero, it's that he really liked to persecute Christians. He really liked to burn them alive to light his gardens at night. And that may be an allusion to this fiery ordeal. But in general, this fiery ordeal is persecution. And when you read the New Testament, especially the book of Acts, you see persecution after persecution after persecution. Whether it's Peter, whether it's Paul, whether it's just the church at large. We see there are attempts on their lives that are made. They're unjustly imprisoned. They're kicked out of cities. Mobs chase them. Mobs yell at them. In fact, in 2 Corinthians 11, 23 to 33, Paul gives us kind of a list of the persecution that he suffered for living like Christ. Beaten times without number, often in danger of death. 5 times I received from the Jews 39 lashes. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was stoned. 3 I was shipwrecked. 1 and day I have spent in the deep. I have been in danger from rivers, robbers, countrymen, Gentiles, in cities, in wilderness, on the sea, from false brethren. I have endured sleepless nights, hunger and thirst, the cold, exposure, and, according to church tradition, when you get to the end of their lives, Paul was beheaded in Rome. Peter was crucified upside down. In fact, of the 12 apostles, the only one who gets to die of old age is John. And he spends the last years of his life in exile on an island. And it's not just Peter, Paul, and the original 12 apostles who are persecuted. If you know anything about church history, for the first 300 years of Christianity, there was just heavy persecution. Whether it's crucifixion, whether it's being burned at the stake, whether it's being fed to lions for entertainment, whether it's having your rights revoked, whether it's heavy taxation, whether it's having your churches burned down, your scriptures burned down, which, by the way, before the printing press, burning a book is a really big deal. And what Peter is telling the Christians who are going to be experiencing this and telling us who are experiencing, albeit a lesser form of persecution, is do not be surprised. This isn't strange. This isn't a fluke in the system. We were told from the get-go by the founder of Christianity, Jesus Christ, that this is what was going to happen. John 15:20, remember what I told you. This is Jesus speaking. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. And so from the start of Christianity, when you sign up to be a Christian, right, it is assumed that persecution is going to come. And Peter also makes this little comment about the persecution, that it comes upon you for your testing. And the idea here, especially since it's described as a fiery ordeal, is that of purifying metal. And this is the basic process of purifying metal, is that you take your lump of whatever unrefined metal that you have, and you stick it in extreme heat. And what that extreme heat does is eventually it melts the metal down, and the dross, all the impurities, come and float to the surface. And then you can scrape the impurities off, you cool the metal down, and you have a really good metal. You have a useful metal. And the same idea here is with persecution. It's for our testing. We start with a weaker faith, which has some impurities in it. Let's be honest with ourselves. It has some impurities in it. And it goes through persecution. That's the heat. And it breaks us down a little bit. But we come out, hopefully, trusting the Lord more, stronger in our faith because the Lord has seen us through the persecution. And now our faith is stronger. Now our faith is better. And so Peter tells us this in verse 13. But to the degree that you share the sufferings of Christ, but to the degree that you suffer for the name of Christ, keep on posting on social media about how awful those persecuting you are. Keep on stockpiling guns and ammo to fight for your rights. Keep on complaining about how unfairly you are being treated to those in the church. It's not in my Bible. But to the degree that you share the sufferings of Christ, to the degree that you are persecuted for living like a Christian, keep on rejoicing. The proper reaction to persecution is rejoicing. And this isn't some funny way to use the word. It literally means happiness. It literally means joy. When you think of rejoicing, that's what Peter is talking about. So the question now is, why? Why is this the case? Well, throughout the book of 1 Peter, he's kind of been making a case, and I'm going to kind of break it down for you, and hopefully I make it make sense. So the underlying assumption is that Peter is talking to Christians. So the underlying assumption here is that you are a Christian. You are someone who has put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. You put your faith in what he has done for you on the cross, in dying for your sins, so that you can have a right relationship with God. You put your faith in his burial and his resurrection, knowing that he has had victory over sin, over death, and has promised us an eternity unlike anything we can believe. So that's where we're starting. You're a Christian, and your faith is genuine. Now, genuine faith always does something. It produces good works. James 2, the back half of it, talks about this at great length. Genuine faith produces good works. Those good works get noticed by the world. And the world hates your good works because the world hates Jesus. And when you are doing these good works and living like Jesus, remember what they did to Jesus? He didn't have a smooth ride. That is the same thing that they're going to do to you. And so when we as Christians see the persecution come, when we experience it for living like Christ, the reason we can rejoice is because it's not the proof, but it is a proof that we are living like Christ. And if it's proof that we're living like Christ, well, then it's proof that we're saved. And if we're saved, we have every reason in the world to rejoice. We have every reason to give thanks continually. And so that's the underlying assumption here. So when you're persecuted for living like Christ, when you're persecuted for acting out an inward change, it is showing you that you're doing the right thing. We rejoice because persecution from the world for living like Christ is a sign that things are going right. It is not a sign that things are going wrong. It is a sign that we are being faithful to the Lord. And those last two sentences I just said are very, very counter to our American sensibilities. Because Americans do not like suffering. They do not like persecution. They want an easy ride, and that's the entirety of the culture. But the biblical answer to suffering is rejoicing, because when you experience persecution, you're doing things right. In fact, in verse 14, he tells you that when you're reviled or when you're harshly criticized for being a Christian, you are blessed. You are highly favored. And so Peter has radically approached the topic of suffering for Christ. When you are persecuted for living for Christ, don't be surprised. It's not strange. It's not a fluke. It is exactly what we were told was going to happen. Instead, we rejoice because we get to share in Christ's suffering. It means that we're doing the right thing when we are persecuted. We are blessed by God. We are highly favored by God when we are persecuted. And we are fellow heirs with Christ. Flip with me to Romans 8. For a brief moment, Romans 8, 16 to 17, and Paul talks about suffering as well. Romans 8, verse 16, the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. And so this suffering is not only proof that we're saved, it's proof that we're fellow heirs with Christ. And it's proof that at the end, whether that's through the rapture, whether that's through us dying, we will be glorified after this brief period of suffering. And so Peter has radically approached suffering, but don't get it twisted. Peter is about to make a clarifying comment about what he's just gone over, because there is suffering well and there is suffering poorly. And this is in verses 15 and 16. Make sure that none of you suffers as a murderer or thief or evildoer or a troublesome meddler. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, he is not to be ashamed, but is to glorify God in this name. So here's what Peter's basically saying. Not all the suffering you are going to go through in this life is because you're living for Christ. Sometimes you're going to suffer persecution because you sinned and you are now reaping the consequences of that sin. And when we suffer this way, when we suffer because we sinned, we're not sharing in the sufferings of Christ because Christ was sinless. Christ was perfect. He was without sin. And so this clarifying comment is directed towards us when we maybe want to say that the reason this person is angry with us or the reason this person is saying those things about us is because we're a Christian, when in reality, we're sinners and we've sinned against them. And that's why they're angry with us. And that's why they're persecuting us. Peter gives us some examples of what suffering for Christ is not. If any of you suffers as a murderer, that one should be pretty simple. Hopefully none of you suffer as a murderer in the legal sense. However, murder isn't just killing another human being. Jesus Christ made this very clear, Matthew 5, 21 to 22. You have heard that the ancients were told, you shall not commit murder, and whoever commits murder shall be liable to the court. All right, we're on track. I totally agree with that, Jesus. Sounds good. Murderers should go to jail. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be guilty before the court. And whoever says to his brother, you good for nothing, shall be guilty before the Supreme Court. And whoever says, you fool, shall be guilty enough to go into the fiery hell. So my question here for you, and it's a rhetorical one, is have you ever gotten angry with someone and acted out on it? And then, follow-up question, did something negative come out of that situation? Did you suffer some negative consequence because you lost your temper? Because you acted out in anger? Because you lashed out? That is not the suffering Peter is talking about. That's not suffering well. He also mentions being a thief. Again, pretty simple. Don't steal stuff. But how many times have we been caught with our hand in the cookie jar and then suffered a negative consequence because of that? That's not the suffering Peter is talking about. Then we have this word evildoer. In the New Revised Standard Version, it has criminal. In the NLT, they make it pretty across the board by just saying making trouble. You can think of this as the time when you knew something was wrong and you did it anyways. Whether that's out of pride, whether that's out of revenge, whether that's out of anger, whether it's just because sin is enjoyable and sin is fun and you wanted to do it. That's what Peter is talking about here. That's someone who does evil deliberately. And my rhetorical question to you is, have you ever done something that you know is wrong and suffered a negative consequence of it? If you have, if the answer is yes, that is not the suffering that Peter is talking about. And then we get to this one, the last one, troublesome meddler. And I think in the day of social media, this is probably the one everybody is the most guilty of. Another translation for troublesome meddler is one who oversees others' affairs. If you have the New Revised Standard Version, you're called a mischief maker. If you have the King James, you're called a busybody. Scripture is really getting to the heart of the matter that if you are sticking your nose in other people's business, meddling in things that don't involve you, whether it's fun, whether it's because you're bored, whether it's because you like the drama, whatever it may be, and then that person gets mad at you because your nose is in their business, you are not suffering for Christ. Suffering the consequences of living out sin does not produce good. Whether it's because you got angry with your spouse or with your child, whether it's because you decided to meddle in the affairs of a coworker or of a friend and the relationship broke down, they got angry with you, you suffered a negative consequence because of that, that's not the suffering that Peter is talking about. Instead of suffering for living in sin, Christians are supposed to be suffering for living for Christ. And when this is happening, when you are suffering as a Christian, do not be ashamed. Because one, you're glorifying God in suffering. That's what verse 16 tells us. You glorify God as a Christian when you suffer for Christ. And because you're suffering for Christ, you know for a fact that you were doing the right thing. So why should you be ashamed? You were doing the right thing, and you are glorifying God in doing the right thing. And so Peter tells us what suffering well is. It's not sinning against somebody and then having them get mad at you. It's living for Christ, living for the truth of his word, living as an authentic Christian, and having the world come after you for it. And that's just going to get worse and worse for us as Christians. It always does. So Peter has made the case for what suffering well is. So for suffering going forward, we have 1 Peter 4, 17 to 19. For it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the outcome of those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is with difficulty that the righteous is saved, what will become of the godless man and the sinner? Therefore, those also who suffer according to the will of God shall entrust their souls to a faithful Creator in doing what is right. So Peter has been talking about persecution for this entire letter. From 1 Peter 1, verses 6 to 7, till 1 Peter 5, verse 10, Peter talks about suffering. From start to end, Peter has been talking about persecution and suffering. And he's just explained a lot, just in the passage that we've read, about how we react to suffering, how we suffer well, and now he's explained to us how we suffer going forward. And here's the case. If suffering begins with us, right? Those of us who are blessed, who are children of God, who are saved. If the suffering starts with us, who have all of these massive benefits being in the household of God, what is the suffering going to be like for the unbeliever? He's making a comparison between the two. We have temporary suffering. And let's be honest, even if you suffer every day of your life as a Christian, and you make it to, let's say, 85 or 90, that's temporary. It's 90 years, which sounds like a long time to us as human beings, but in light of eternity, that is a very short period of time. That's what we have. We have temporary suffering that, one, glorifies God, and two, helps us grow in our faith, and lasts for maybe a few decades. And then, what we have waiting for us are the eternal glories of heaven. Glorified bodies, where there is no more pain, no more sin, no more sickness, no more sorrow, where we live with God and God dwells among us in a perfect heavens, a perfect earth that is totally untainted by sin. So, this is our end of the deal. We have the better end of the deal as Christians. As people who have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we get the better end of the deal. Temporary suffering for eternal reward versus the unbeliever, who does not suffer the same way we do. The world doesn't attack its own. However, let's say they have a hunky-dory life for 90 years. That's it. They have temporary comfort for an eternity far away from the Lord, for an eternity separated from God in hell. And so he's contrasting these two because he doesn't want us to get it twisted. And he's reminding us that because we have so much to look forward to and so much promise to us, and we have experienced the love of Christ so personally as Christians, therefore, because all of those things are true, those also who suffer according to the will of God shall revolt against the government, shall hate other people for persecuting them or sinning against them, shall post negative things on social media, shall complain in the church, shall fight for their God-given American rights. That's a very American thing to say. That's not what my Bible says. Maybe it's what yours says, but I wouldn't trust that version if that's what yours says. It says none of those things. It says, therefore, because we have these promises of heaven waiting for us, those who suffer according to God's will, notice that. Verse 12 tells us that persecution comes upon us for our testing, and verse 19 tells us that we are suffering according to the will of God, which just goes further into saying that the suffering you experience is not a fluke. It's part of God's plan to cause your faith to grow. It's part of God's plan to make you more like Jesus Christ, which is infinitely more important than being comfortable or happy. It is infinitely more important to be like his son, Jesus Christ. But therefore, those also who suffer according to the will of God shall entrust their souls to a faithful Creator in doing what is right. In other words, when suffering and persecution come because we are living for Christ, what we are supposed to do as Christians is trust the Lord and do what is right. That is it. We trust God to know what he's doing. You know, he's only omniscient, all-powerful, all-present, creator God. And we continue to live for Christ. And kind of the funny thing is that when we are persecuted and we continue to live for Christ, the persecution will just keep coming. And the faith will just keep growing. And do you want, as a closing, do you want the best example of what trusting in the Lord and doing what is right under persecution looks like. Because it's in 1 Peter. In fact, it's the climactic passage of 1 Peter. It is 1 Peter 2, 21 to 25. It's what we read this morning. So you can flip there and we'll read it. This is where we will close. 1 Peter 2, 21 to 25. For you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example to follow in his steps, who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to him who judges righteously. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds you were healed. For you were continually straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. When persecution and suffering comes for living like Christ, Christians must suffer well following Christ's example. Biblical suffering is not glorious. There's no revolution. There's no sticking it to the man. There's no big fight, big climactic battle. And so to the world, it's not very glorious. And to our American sensibilities, it's not very glorious. But biblical suffering follow Jesus' example. When we are abusively insulted or harshly criticized, we do not return the favor. When we are attacked, we utter no threats. And through all of the suffering, all of the persecution, we trust God. And this isn't easy. It's not easy. I don't want you to think that suffering well is easy. But when we suffer well for being Christians, for living like Christ, for being radically different from the world, we can rejoice in our sufferings, we trust God to be in control, and we continue to do what is right. And what this does is it helps us to be more like Christ, and it glorifies God in our lives. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for this day, and I thank you for another day that you have given us, and I thank you for your word, and that it has an entire book just dedicated to how we should respond to suffering and how we should see suffering as Christians. I thank you that you have made it clear from the get-go that if we are going to live for you, if we are going to live an authentic Christian life for you, suffering is going to come, but that we don't have to be scared of it. We don't even have to be ashamed of it. But we can rejoice knowing that we're doing the right thing. We can rejoice knowing that it glorifies you, knowing that it's growing our faith, helping us to be more like your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the perfect example of suffering for us, and that ultimately it helps us to be more like your Son, Jesus Christ. And so I thank you that currently we do not endure the same suffering as seen in some countries around the world, but I pray that when it does come, in whatever form it may, we would take it upon ourselves to follow your example and to suffer well, to be a testimony to you in how we react, to glorify you in our lives, and to be more like your Son, Jesus Christ. I pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Please stand with us as we conclude our service with Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Souls of men, you are the one that we pray. Master Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. Offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one with me, praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your all, here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger.
Loving Heavenly Father, I pray that our hearts hunger for you. And so that when we do suffer, that hunger in our hearts will help us to suffer well and suffer for you. Because, Lord, you suffered for us on that cruel cross on Calvary to take every sin that we will ever commit. And you bore them for us. Father God, I pray that you would just strengthen us, encourage us in these days. That in those moments when we want to fight back, we want to threaten, we want to hurt, Lord, that you would just remind us that you turn the other cheek. Father God, I thank you for the courage that you had. And I pray that we just have a little bit of that. And we ask all these things in Jesus' wonderful and precious name. Amen.